Chapter 18 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This Librivox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. General Ashley retires. After the rendezvous had broken up in July and Ashley's party had begun the journey to St. Louis with the furs, the body of trappers left behind under the command of Sublette moved leisurely up the Green River for a considerable distance. Then, having agreed upon Cache Valley as the place for the fall rendezvous, the trappers separated into small parties and spent the summer working along the streams in the country east of the Wasatch Mountains. It was along about the end of October, 1825, and the winter was already setting in, when one of the small bands that had worked its way to the headwaters of the Salt River during the fall hunt fell in with three men who had just arrived from St. Louis with a letter for Sublette from General Ashley. The three men were James P. Beckworth, one LaRoche, and one Pello. It would appear that during his homeward journey, Ashley had concluded that he was wealthy enough to retire, and it is probable that he had discussed with Jedediah Smith some proposition regarding the sale of his mountain interests to a new firm, of which Smith and Sublette should be members. It was doubtless with this in view that, shortly after arriving in St. Louis, he had induced Beckworth and his two companions to carry a message to Sublette far away beyond the Great Divide. Beckworth tells us that he received $1,000 for the trip, and considering the great risk that so small a party ran, such remuneration could hardly be regarded as excessive, though it is likely that far less was received. Setting forth from St. Louis with two riding horses and a pack mule for each, these three men had followed the Missouri River to the mouth of the Platte, ascended the latter to the Forks, thence proceeding by way of the North Platte and the Sweetwater through South Pass to the Green. After pushing up the Green to the mouth of LaBarge Creek, they had struck across country northwestward to the headwaters of the Salt River, which empties into the Snake River, where the latter crosses the eastern boundary of Idaho. The trappers whom they met at this point were about to start for the rendezvous in Cache Valley, and Beckworth decided to accompany them to that place, there to await the arrival of Sublette rather than to search for him in the wilderness. It was late in October when the widely scattered bands had at last reunited in Cache Valley, and Sublette's party was the last to come in. Upon arriving, Sublette gave orders for the whole camp to prepare for the march to the mouth of the Weber River, where he had decided to winter. At this time, the Ashley men, including hired trappers, free trappers, and those who had deserted Ogden, must have numbered about 100. Most of these had taken Indian wives, some had children, and as many horses were required to transport the impedimenta of such a camp, the procession that trailed out of Cache Valley must have been rather impressive. Joseph Meek, who became one of Sublette's trappers 4 years later, has left us the following account of the manner in which such a party traveled. When the large camp is on the march, it has a leader, generally one of the bushways, who rides in advance or at the head of the column. Near him is a led mule, chosen for qualities of speed and trustworthiness, on which are packed two small trunks that balance each other, like panniers, and which contain the company's books, papers, and articles of agreement with the men. Then follow the pack animals, each one bearing three packs, one on each side and one on top, so nicely adjusted as not to slip in traveling. These are in charge of certain men, called camp keepers, who have each three of these to look after. The trappers and hunters have two horses or mules, one to ride and one to pack their traps. If there are women and children in the train, they are all mounted. Where the country is safe, the caravan moves in single file, often stretching out for half or three-quarters of a mile. At the end of the column rides the second man, or little bushway, usually a hired officer, whose business it is to look after the order and condition of the whole camp. On arriving at a suitable spot upon which to make the night camp, the leader stops, dismounts in the particular space which is to be devoted to himself in its midst. The others, as they come up, form a circle, the second man bringing up the rear to be sure all are there. He then proceeds to appoint every man a place in the circle, and to examine the horses' backs, to see if any are sore. The horses are then turned out, under guard, to graze. But before darkness comes on, they are placed inside the ring and picketed by a stake driven in the earth or with 2 feet tied together so as to prevent easy or free locomotion. The men are divided into messes, so many trappers and so many camp keepers to a mess. The business of eating is not a very elaborate one, where the sole diet is meat, either dried or roasted. By a certain hour, all is quiet in camp, and only the guard is awake. In the morning at daylight, the second man comes forth from his lodge and cries in French, "Leve, leve, leve," which is the command to rise. In about 5 minutes more, he cries, "Lece lego, lece lego," or turn out," at which command all come out from the lodges, and the horses are turned loose to feed, but not before a horseman has galloped all around the camp at some distance and discovered everything to be safe in the neighborhood. Again, when the horses have been sufficiently fed under the eye of a guard, they are driven up, the packs replaced, the train mounted, and once more it moves off in the order before mentioned. Thus Ashley's men, with their women, children, and horses, move down the Bear River to Salt Lake, and along the border of the lake, southward to the mouth of the Weber, where they establish themselves in their skin tents for the winter. Now that the trapping season was over, the men had a comparatively easy time, having little to do but to take turns in supplying the camp with meat, and to indulge themselves in eating, sleeping, and swapping yarns, for we may be sure that most of the more menial duties about camp, such as cooking and fetching wood and water, were willingly performed by the squaws, as being well beneath the dignity of their lords. Joseph Meek describes certain features of domestic economy in these winter camps. When a piece of game is brought in, a deer or an antelope or buffalo meat, it is thrown down in front of the Bushway's lodge, and the second man stands by and cuts it up, or has it cut up for him. The first man who chances to come along is ordered to stand still and turn his back to the pile of game, while the little Bushway lays hold of a piece that has been cut off and asks in a loud voice, "Who will have this?" And the man, answering for him, says, "The Bushway," or perhaps "Number 6 or "Number 20, meaning certain messes, and the number is called to come and take the meat. In this blind way, the meat is portioned out, the Bushway faring no better than his men. Not long after winter quarters had been established, so we are told by Beckworth, who was there, a party of Bannock Indians swooped down upon the camp one stormy night and drove away 80 of the white men's horses. Here was work that could not be allotted to the squaws, and such work as the trappers seemed rather to enjoy. 50 men immediately volunteered to pursue the Bannocks, and it is safe to guess that most of those who had been on Green River in the spring of 1824 and had shared in the attack on the Snake Village were of this band, which, like the former one, was led by Fitzpatrick. Early next morning, the horse hunters set out afoot. The storm had died in the night, and, as much snow had fallen, the stolen herd had left a trail that was easily followed. After trudging 5 days in a northerly direction, the trappers came at last in sight of the Bannock Village. Fitzpatrick now divided his party into 2 bands, one of which was led by himself, the other by the young daredevil, James Bridger, who was to drive away the Bannock horses while Fitzpatrick and his men charged the Indians, numbering about 300. It was surely an audacious plan, but it seemed to have worked perfectly. The whole Bannock herd was driven away, though many of the horses were later recovered by the Indians. "We succeeded in getting off with a number of our own missing horses and 40 head besides," says Beckworth, who shared in the enterprise. In the engagement, 6 of the enemy were killed and scalped, while not one of our party received a scratch. The horses we captured were very fine ones, and our return to camp was greeted with the liveliest demonstrations. When the horse hunters reached winter quarters, they found there an encampment of Snake Indians numbering over 1,000. These, so Beckworth tells us, had entirely surrounded us with their lodges, adding very materially to our population. They were perfectly friendly, and we apprehended no danger from them. It appears that this was their usual resort for spending the winter. During the absence of Fitzpatrick's party, Sublette, owing doubtless to the letter received from Ashley, had decided that his business interests made necessary his presence in St. Louis, and he had started with but one companion, Black Harris, on the trail that led back to the States, 1,500 miles away across the blizzard-swept prairie wilderness. The wintering party, all strong and healthy as bears, as we are assured, now settled down to a comfortable and neighborly existence in company with their snake friends, the presence of whom made unlikely any further attack by marauding bands of horse thieves. So passed the winter of 1825-26. Early in the spring of 1826, four men, whose names are not recorded, set out in small bull boats from the camp at the mouth of the Weber River to skirt the shore of the Great Salt Lake. Their purpose was to locate beaver streams and to find the place whence the Buenaventura issued, flowing westward to the ocean. After 3 weeks, these men, having circumnavigated the lake, returned to camp with a tale of unprofitable labors. They had found neither beaver nor the Buenaventura, and they had suffered much with thirst, for most of the streams that entered the lake were saline at that early season before the floodwaters of the melting snow had washed them clean. During the absence of the exploring party, the main body had been preparing to leave winter quarters and begin the spring hunt. Many of the skins, which had been used for lodges and were therefore thoroughly cured by the smoke of the winter fires, were cut up and made into moccasins for the party. Smoked skins do not shrink with wetting as raw skins do. This is an important quality in a moccasin, so Joseph Meek tells us, as a trapper is almost constantly in the water during the trapping season, and should not his moccasins be smoked, they will close upon his feet in drying like a vise. Sometimes after trapping all day, the tired and soaked trapper lies down in his blankets at night, still wet. By and by, he is wakened by the pinching of his moccasins, and is obliged to rise and seek the water again to relieve himself of the pain. For the same reason, when the spring comes, the trapper is forced to cut off the lower half of his buckskin breeches, and piece them down with blanket leggings, which he wears all through the trapping season. The whole body of trappers and Indians now broke camp and moved together up Bear River to Cache Valley, where 45 packs of beaver, collected during the previous fall, were cached. During this operation, two French-Canadian trappers were killed by the caving in of a clay bank in which they were digging, and Beckworth, with his usual loquacity, tells us that he fell heir to the widow of one of these unfortunates. She was of light complexion, says he, smart, trim, and active, and never tired in her efforts to please me, seeming to think that she belonged to me for the remainder of her life. I had never had a servant before, and I found her of great service to me in keeping my clothes in repair, making my bed, and taking care of my weapons. From Cache Valley the trappers started on the spring hunt, pushing over to the headwaters of the Port Neuf, and down that stream to its junction with the Snake River, finding plenty of beaver all the way. At this point, they seem to have had a brisk encounter with a large band of Blackfeet, as a result of which they lost three horses. However, they took some scalps by way of partial remuneration. They then turned back, ascending the Port Neuf to its headwaters, from whence they crossed over to the Bear River, continuing the hunt along that stream and its tributaries until they reached the mouth of Sage Creek. There they met Black Harris and one Portelace, who had just arrived from the States. These brought the news that Ashley, Smith, and Sublette were but a short distance away, bound for Salt Lake with 50 men and a pack train of 100 horses and mules, having begun the journey from St. Louis in early March. Upon receiving this news, the trappers hastened back to Salt Lake, being joined on the way by the Snake Indians who had spent the previous winter with them. Shortly after they reached the appointed place of rendezvous on Salt Lake, Ashley's party came in with a pack train, heavily laden with merchandise, and the business of the rendezvous began. It may well be supposed, so Beckworth remarks, that the arrival of such a vast amount of luxuries from the East did not pass off without a general celebration. Mirth, songs, dancing, shouting, trading, running, jumping, racing, target shooting, yarns, frolic, with all sorts of extravagances that white men or Indians could invent, were freely indulged in. The unpacking of the medicine water, alcohol, contributed not a little to the heightening of our festivities. However, the festivities were rudely interrupted during the second day, when a body of Blackfeet, prowling in the vicinity, surprised and killed five of the Snake Indians, who were gathering roots at some distance from the camp. Whereupon the Snake chief went to Sublette and said, "Cut Face, three of my warriors and two women have just been killed by the Blackfeet. You say that your warriors can fight, that they are great braves. Now let me see them fight, that I may know your words are true." Sublette replied, "You shall see them fight, and then you will know that they are all braves, that I have no cowards among my men, and that they are all ready to die for their Snake friends." Beckworth, whom we have been quoting, tells us that the ensuing battle continued for 6 hours, after which Sublette's men, having become very hungry as a result of their violent exercise, retired to their camp, requesting that the Snakes remain on the field and finish the job. But the Snakes, it seems, had also developed considerable appetites by this time, and concluding that under the circumstances they would rather eat than fight, they followed their allies to the feast. So the battle ended pleasantly enough. During the rendezvous, General Ashley completed arrangements with Jedediah Smith, David E. Jackson, and William L. Sublette, whereby he transferred his interests in the mountains to the firm of Smith, Jackson, and Sublette, agreeing to furnish the new company with goods from the States and to dispose of its furs on a commission basis. The articles of agreement were drawn up and signed on July 26, 1826, near the Grand Lake, west of the Rocky Mountains. Before leaving the country for the last time, so Beckworth informs us, the general delivered the following farewell address. "Mountaineers and friends, when I first came to the mountains, I came a poor man. You, by your indefatigable exertions, toils, and privations, have procured me an independent fortune. With ordinary prudence in the management of what I have accumulated, I shall never want for anything. For this, my friends, I feel myself under great obligations to you. Many of you have served with me personally, and I shall always be proud to testify to the fidelity with which you have stood by me through all danger, and the friendly and brotherly manner which you have ever, one and all, evinced toward me. For these faithful and devoted services, I wish you to accept my thanks. The gratitude I express to you springs from my heart, and will ever retain a lively hold on my feelings. My friends, I am about to leave you to take up my abode in St. Louis. Whenever any of you return thither, your first duty must be to call at my house, to talk over the scenes of peril we have encountered, and partake of the best cheer my table can afford. I now wash my hands of the toils of the Rocky Mountains. Farewell, mountaineers and friends. May God bless you all." End of chapter 18. Chapter 19 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. The First Americans Overland to California. Immediately upon taking over Ashley's interests in the mountains, Smith, Jackson, and Sublette began to make plans for extending the business. The country drained by the Green, the Bear, the Weber, and the Upper Snake Rivers was still rich in beaver, but yonder, between the Great Salt Lake and the setting sun, lay a land unknown. What incalculable wealth of fur might be waiting there in a trapper's paradise of pleasant valleys! And somewhere through that country did not the mighty Buenaventura River flow westward to the Pacific? Here was stuff enough for the fashioning of big dreams. Beyond that unknown land was California. Might it not be possible to transport furs to some Spanish port, thence to be sent around the Horn by the New England trading ships that were constantly on the coast in those years? It will be remembered that in the late fall of 1824, Jedediah Smith had accompanied Ross to Flathead House, the Hudson Bay Company post on Clark's Fork of the Columbia, east of the Bitterroot Mountains. While there, he had learned much regarding the successful operations of the British traders, and he could not have failed to appreciate the immense advantage they enjoyed with their access to the sea by way of the Columbia. It was natural that the young Americans should covet a like advantage, especially as the memory of Astor's great enterprise that had failed but 12 years before was fresh in their minds, and still bore the glamour of high adventure. Might not the Buenaventura prove to be a second Columbia? It was decided that an exploring party should be sent through the unknown country to the sea. 3 years had passed since Jedediah Smith, who was now just 28 years old, had joined Ashley's band at St. Louis, and from the beginning he had been a man of mark. His conduct in the first battle with the Rees, and his perilous journey afterward to Major Henry at the mouth of the Yellowstone, had distinguished him for extraordinary courage, and since that time he had demonstrated shrewdness in business matters, common sense, and a gift for leadership. For these reasons, and because, being better educated than either of his comrades, he was the best fitted to deal with the Spanish authorities on the coast, it was decided that he should lead the exploring party. We can fancy with what eagerness he must have accepted this task, for had he not pored over the vast triangular white space on the maps of the period and dreamed of penetrating its mystery? Now the dream was coming true. However, judging by the direction he took on his outward journey, it would seem that his first concern was with finding a practicable route to California. On the 22nd of August, 1826, Smith started southward from the place of rendezvous on Great Salt Lake with 15 men, 50 horses, and a stock of merchandise, leaving his partners, Jackson and Sublette, with the remainder of the band, to continue operations in the fur country already explored, and agreeing to meet them, if possible, at the southern end of Bear Lake during the summer of 1827. Those who accompanied Smith are worthy of remembrance, for they were the first Americans to reach California by land, the vanguard of the great invasion that was to be in full swing a quarter of a century later. Their names are as follows: Harrison G. Rogers, Silas Goble, Arthur Black, John Gator, Robert Evans, Manuel Lazarus, John Hanna, John Wilson, Martin McCoy, Daniel Ferguson, Peter Rene, a Negro, Abraham LaPlante, James Reed, John Rubasco, and one Robeso. Following the valley of the Jordan River from Great Salt Lake, Smith's party skirted the eastern shore of Utah Lake. Having reached the point where the lake shore bears westward, they struck out across the barren country to the southwest, and in early September came upon the Sevier River, flowing in a northerly direction. Smith called this Ashley's River, and assumed that it emptied into Utah Lake, a natural assumption considering the direction of the stream and the fact that he had reached it at a considerable distance south of the abrupt bend from which it flows southwesterly into Sevier Lake. Just 50 years before, the two Franciscan padres, Dominguez and Escalante, in their misguided search for a direct route from Santa Fe to Monterey, had passed that way with a party of 8, en route to Utah Lake. Since then, no white man had penetrated that solitude until now. Smith's band pushed on southward up the valley of the Sevier. The last signs of buffalo had been seen before leaving Utah Lake, but antelope and mountain sheep were still to be found in small numbers, and black-tailed hares were abundant, so that the men as yet did not suffer want. While ascending this stream, they came upon a small village of Sanpet Indians, called Sanpatch by Smith. The fact that these wore rabbit-skin robes is sufficient indication that big game was very scarce in that region. Few in numbers and poverty-stricken, it is not surprising that this tribe was friendly disposed toward the white men, who must have seemed immensely rich and powerful with their buckskin clothes, their rifles, and their pack animals laden with merchandise. From the headwaters of the Sevier, the explorers crossed the divide southward, and near the end of September reached the headwaters of the Virgin, of a muddy cast and a little brackish, which Smith called Adams River, in compliment to our president. With mountains to their left and a sandy waste broken by occasional rocky hills on their right, they descended the Virgin through a country where even jackrabbits were scarce. They now began to know hunger, and their horses grew lean and weak for want of grass, nor did their meeting with the Paiute Indians bring them much relief, These, like the sandpets on the Sevier, wore rabbit-skin robes and were poor, though we are told that they raised some little corn and pumpkins. After 10 days of marching down the Virgin, so Smith tells us, he discovered a large cave on the west side of the river, the entrance of which is about 10 or 15 feet high and 5 or 6 feet in width, the roof, sides, and floor being solid rock salt. 2 days farther downstream, through a region where little grew but cacti and stunted shrubs, they reached the point where the Virgin empties into the Colorado. Crossing the Colorado, which Smith calls the Seed-Skeeter, Siskiyou, thus identifying it with Green River, the band traveled down the valley 4 days, finding the country remarkably barren, rocky, and mountainous. We are not told how they managed to exist during this time, but it is reasonable to assume that they lived on horse meat. At length they came upon the Mojave Indians, whom Smith calls the Amuchavas, dwelling in a place where the valley, opening out to a width of from 5 to 15 miles, was well timbered and fertile. The Mojaves were well supplied with corn, beans, pumpkins, watermelons, and wheat. "I was now nearly destitute of horses," says Smith, "and had learned what it was to do without food. I therefore remained there 15 days and recruited my men, and I was enabled also to exchange my horses and purchase a few more of a few runaway Indians who stole some from the Spaniards. I here got information of the Spanish countries, the Californias, obtained 2 good guides, and recrossed the Seed-Skeeter, which I afterwards found emptied into the Gulf of California by the name of the Colorado. Having crossed the Colorado at Needles during the first week of November, Smith and his band struck out across the desert. I traveled a west course 15 days, he says, over a country of complete barrens, generally traveling from morning until night without water. I crossed a salt plain about 20 miles long and 8 wide. On the surface was a crust of beautiful white salt, quite thin. Under this surface there is a layer of salt from 1/2 to 1.5 inches in depth. Between this and the upper layer there is about 4 inches of yellowish sand. Anyone who has crossed the Mojave Desert on the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe Railroad, the route of which is approximately that followed by Smith, can easily imagine what hardships were suffered by this party. They had started from Great Salt Lake with 50 horses, and though they had purchased a number while resting among the Mojave Indians, they had but 18 when they reached the Spanish settlements of California. Some had doubtlessly been eaten, but most had died for want of pasturage and water. On Sunday evening, November 26, 1826, Smith's party encamped on a point about 18 miles east of San Gabriel Mission, situated near the Pueblo of Los Angeles. The next morning, so says Harrison G. Rogers in his journal, "we got ready as early as possible and started a west course and traveled 14 miles and encamped for the day. We passed innumerable herds of cattle, horses, and some hundreds of sheep. We passed 4 or 5 Indian lodges, that their Indians act as herdsmen. There came an old Indian to us that speaks good Spanish, and took us with him to his mansion, which consisted of 2 rows of large and lengthy buildings that remind me of the British barracks. So soon as we encamped, there was plenty to eat, a fine young cow killed, and plenty of cornmeal given us. Pretty soon after, the 2 commandants of the missionary establishment, San Gabriel, came to us and had the appearance of gentlemen. Mr. Smith went with them to the mansion, mission, and I stayed with the company. There was great feasting among the men, as they were pretty hungry, not having any good meat for some time. The next day, so Rogers continues, Mr. Smith wrote me that he was received as a gentleman, and treated as such, and that he wished me to go back and look for a pistol that was lost, and send the company on to the missionary establishment. I complied with his request, went back and found the pistol, and arrived late in the evening. Was received very politely, and showed into a room and my arms taken from me. About 10 o'clock at night, supper was served, and Mr. Smith and myself sent for. I was introduced to the 2 priests over a glass of good old whiskey, and found them to be very jovial, friendly gentlemen. The supper consisted of a number of different dishes, served different from any table I ever saw, plenty of good wine during supper. Before the cloth was removed, cigars were introduced. It was a strange society into which these American trappers had come, almost like men from another planet. Their trail from St. Louis up the Missouri, the Platte, and the Sweetwater, through South Pass to Salt Lake by way of the Bear River, past Utah Lake, up the Sevier, down the Virgin and Colorado, and westward across the Mojave Desert, had led them far as to space, but farther as to time, for they had actually journeyed backward, through the past of the race, to a pastoral, theocratic age. At this point, a brief sketch of early California history may not come amiss. In 1543, Juan Cabrillo, a Spanish navigator, had explored the southern coast of Upper California. Then, and for many years thereafter, supposed to be an island or an archipelago, with an extension of the Gulf of California on the east and the mythical Strait of Anian, an arm of Hudson Bay, on the north. In the 80s and 90s of the same century, two Spanish galleons, trading with the Philippines from the west coast of Mexico, had touched upon the California shore, and in 1602, Sebastian Vizcaino had discovered the bays of San Diego and Monterey. For over a century and a half thereafter, the country, though regarded as belonging to the Spanish crown, was unvisited and remained little more than a name associated with the northern mystery. Now and then a galleon, homeward bound from the Philippines, sighted its lonely headlands afar and sailed on. In the middle of the 18th century, the Russians began the exploration of Alaska, and Spain, fearing the new influence growing up in the far north, alarmed at the increasing frequency with which the English privateers were appearing in the Pacific, and having long felt the need of a refitting port for her Manila galleons, was aroused to a new interest in the land that she had so long neglected, and decided to occupy it. At this time, however, the Spanish government was too poor to undertake the conquest of the vast domain by force of arms, and so the task was delegated to the Franciscan Order of Missionary Friars. I. B. Richmond remarks upon the singular efficacy of the cross in the subjugation of men, a fact which the Spanish religious orders had already demonstrated in the Philippine Islands, Paraguay, and Lower California. The leader of the great movement which now began was the famous Father Junipero Serra. In 1768, he accompanied the sacred expedition under José de Galvez, the purpose of which was to establish missions at certain strategic points along the California coast. The first, San Diego de Alcala, was founded in July 1769. The second, San Carlos Borromeo, near the present Monterey, in 1770. The third, San Antonio de Padua, on the San Antonio River, in July 1771, and San Gabriel Arcangel, the fourth, in September of the same year. From that time on, the movement had grown rapidly. At the time of Jedediah Smith's arrival, there were 23 thriving missions in Upper California, reaching from the Bay of San Francisco to San Diego Bay. Of these, San Gabriel was one of the most important, owing to the fertility of the region and to the fact that there the overland route from the Colorado River met the trail from Lower California. In spite of the undeniably pious intentions of the Padres, these missions had grown to be something more than religious institutions concerned with the salvation of the Indian soul. They were commercial concerns under theocratic control, and flourishing by virtue of a practically unlimited supply of slave labor. The Indian neophytes tended the flocks and herds, spun wool, tanned hides, made tallow and soap, raised wheat, hemp, grapes, olives, oranges, and manufactured various articles in leather, wood, and iron. A profitable trade in hides and tallow had for many years been carried on with the Boston ships that came around the Horn, a voyage that often required as much as 6 months to make. R. H. Dana, in 2 Years Before the Mast, has left us a vivid account of that industry as it was carried on along the coast during the period with which we are concerned. 4 years before Smith's arrival, the province of Upper California had given allegiance to Mexico, which had broken away from Spain in 1811. Now the cordial reception of the first overland Americans by the benevolent and lovable Padres of San Gabriel Mission proved to be somewhat misleading, for there was another power in the country with which the party was obliged to reckon, the civil authorities. As we have seen, the first settlements in California had been founded as the result of suspicion and fear, suspicion of the Russians, fear of the British buccaneers of the type of Hawkins and Drake. Since the ship Otter of Boston had dropped anchor in the Bay of Monterey just 30 years before, the Americans had come to be regarded with some dread, and not without cause, as history has long since made plain, and as the conduct of the Boston smugglers and traders along the coast had already demonstrated. We Americans are a virile, driving breed, and we must have seemed rather grasping and godless to the ease-loving Spaniards of the coast in those days. Why had these barbaric trappers from the central wilds of the continent entered California? Was a new race of Goths looking lustfully upon a new Italy? Immediately upon arriving at San Gabriel, Smith was informed that he could not proceed without a passport from the civil authorities, and accordingly he wrote a letter to the governor of the province, Jose Maria de Echeandia, whose official residence was then at San Diego, giving reasons for his presence in the country and asking permission to continue his journey northward. Smith's reasons seem to have been rather more strategic than factual, and considering those with whom he had to deal, he was doubtless justified in making them so. The governor was given to understand that the party had been compelled for want of provisions and water to enter California. Though an answer was expected within a few days, more than a month was to elapse before satisfactory arrangements could be made with Echeandia. And knowing this, we may as well pass the time among the luxury-loving padres with Harrison G. Rogers. Here follow extracts from his diary. November 29th. Still at the mansion, mission. We were sent for about sunrise to drink a cup of tea and eat some bread and cheese. They all appear friendly and treat us well. Although they are Catholics by profession, they allow us the liberty of conscience and treat us as they do their own countrymen and brethren. About 11 o'clock, dinner was ready, and the priest came after us to go and dine. We were invited into the office and invited to take a glass of gin and water and eat some bread and cheese. Directly after, we were seated at dinner, and everything went on in style, both the priest being pretty merry, the clerk, and one other gentleman who speaks some English. They all appeared to be gentlemen of the first class, both in manners and habits. The mission consists of 4 rows of houses, forming a complete square, where there are all kinds of mechanics at work. The church faces the east, and the guardhouse the west. The north and south line comprises the workshops. They have large vineyards, apple and peach orchards, and some orange and fig trees. They manufacture blankets and sundry other articles. They distill whiskey and grind their own grain, having a water mill of tolerable quality. They have upwards of 1,000 persons employed, men, women, and children, Indians of various nations. The situation is very handsome, pretty streams of water running through from all quarters, some thousands of acres of fertile land, as level as a die in view, and a part under cultivation, surrounded on the north with a high mountain, handsomely timbered with pine and cedar, and on the south with low mountains covered with grass. Cattle, this mission has upward of 30,000 head of cattle, and horses, sheep, hogs, etc., in proportion. They slaughter at this place from 2,000 to 3,000 head of cattle at a time. The mission lives on the profits. November 30th. There was a wedding in this place today, and Mr. Smith and myself invited. The bell was rung a little before sunrise, and the morning service performed. Then the music commenced serenading, the soldiers firing, etc. About 7 o'clock, tea and bread served. About 11, dinner and music. The ceremony and dinner were held at the priest's. They had an elegant dinner, consisting of a number of dishes, boiled and roast meat and fowl, wine and brandy, grapes brought as a dessert. Mr. Smith and myself acted quite independent, not understanding their language, nor they ours. We endeavored to apologize, being very dirty and not in a situation to shift our clothing, but no excuse would be taken. They treated us as gentlemen in every sense of the word. And although our apparel is so indifferent, and we not being in circumstances at this time to help ourselves, being about 800 miles on a direct line from the place of our deposit, Our two Indian guides were imprisoned in the guardhouse the second day after we arrived at the missionary establishment, and remain confined as yet. December 1st, 1826. We still remain at the mission of San Gabriel. Things going on as usual, all friendship and peace. Mr. Smith set his blacksmiths, James Reed and Silas Goble, to work in the blacksmith shop to make a bear trap for the priest, agreeable to promise yesterday. Mr. Smith and the interpreter went in the evening to the next mission, called San Pedro, on San Pedro Bay, a Spanish gentleman from the mission having sent his servant with horses for them. Mr. Smith informed me this morning that he had to give Reed a little flogging yesterday evening on account of some impertinence. He appeared more complacent this morning than usual. December 2nd. Mr. Smith has not returned from the mission as yet. This province is called the Province of New California. This mission ships annually from $20,000 to $25,000 worth of hides and tallow, and about $20,000 worth of soap. The Indians appear to be much altered from the wild Indians in the mountains that we have passed. They are kept in great fear. For the least offense, they are corrected. They are complete slaves in every sense of the word. Mr. Smith and LaPlante returned late in the evening and represent their treatment to be good at the other mission. Mr. Smith tells me that Mr. Francisco, the Spanish gentleman that he went to visit, promises him as many horses and mules as he wants. December 4th, still at San Gabriel, things much as usual. The priest presented Mr. Smith with two pieces of shirting containing 64 yards, four to make the men's shirts, all being nearly naked. December 7th. No answer as yet from the governor of the province. Mr. Smith and all hands getting impatient. December 8th. Mr. Smith was sent for to go to San Diego to see the governor. Captain Cunningham, commanding the ship Courier, now lying in the port at San Diego, arrived here late this evening. The captain is a Bostonian and has been trading on the coast for hides and tallow since June last. He informs me that he is rather under the impression that he shall be obliged to remain until sometime in the succeeding summer, in consequence of so much opposition, as there are a number of vessels on the coast trading for the same articles. Mr. Martinez tells me that there are between 16,000 and 17,000 natives that are converted to the Catholic faith and under the control of the different missions. The white population he estimates at 6,000, making 22,000 or 23,000 souls in the province of New California. December 9th, Mr. Smith and one of the men, in company with Captain Cunningham, left San Gabriel this morning for San Diego, the governor's place of residence. December 10th, Sunday. There were 5 Indians brought to the mission and sentenced to be whipped for not going to work when ordered. Each received from 12 to 14 lashes. They were all old men, say from 50 to 60 years. The commandant, standing by with his sword to see the Indian who flogged them, did his duty. They keep at this place 4 small field pieces, 2 6-pounders and 2 2-pounders, to protect them from the Indians in case they should rebel. December 13th. I walked through the workshops. I saw some Indians blacksmithing, some carpentering, others making the woodwork of plows, others employed in making spinning wheels for the squaws to spin on. There are upwards of 60 women employed in spinning yarn and weaving. Our blacksmiths have been employed for several days, making horseshoes and nails for our own use when we leave here. December 14th. I was asked by the priest to let our blacksmiths make a large trap for him to set in his orange garden to catch the Indians when they come up at night to rob his orchard. December 18th. I received a letter from Mr. Smith informing me that he was rather under the impression that he would be detained for some time yet, as the general did not like to take the responsibility on himself to let us pass until he received instructions from the general in Mexico. Our men have been employed in fitting out a cargo of hides, tallow, and soap for a Mr. Henry Edwards. He is what they call here a Mexican trader. December 19th. This mission, if properly managed, would be equal to a mine of silver or gold. Their farms are extensive. They raise from 3,000 to 4,000 bushels of wheat annually and sell to shippers for $3 per bushel. the annual income, situated as it is, and managed so badly by the Indians, is worth, in hides, tallow, soap, wine, brandy, wheat, and corn, from $55,000 to $60,000. December 20th. I expect an answer from Mr. Smith in 6 or 8 days if he does not get permission to pass on. My situation is a very delicate one, as I have to be among the grandees of the country every day. I make a very grotesque appearance when seated at table amongst the dandies with their ruffles, silks, and broadclothes. January 6, 1827. This being what is called Epiphany or Old Christmas Day, church held early as usual. Men, women, and children attend. After church, the ceremonies as on Sundays. Wine issued abundantly to both Spaniards and Indians. Music played by the Indian band. After the issue of the morning, our men, in company with some Spaniards, went and fired a salute, and the old padre gave them wine, bread, and meat as a treat. Some of the men got drunk, and two of them, James Reed and Daniel Ferguson, commenced fighting, and some of the Spaniards interfered and struck one of our men by the name of Black, which came very near terminating with bad consequences. Our blacksmith, James Reed, came very abruptly into the priest's dining-room while at dinner and asked for brandy. The priest ordered a plate of victuals to be handed to him. He ate a few mouthfuls and set the plate on the table, and then took up the decanter of wine and drank without invitation, and came very near breaking the glass when he set it down. The padre, seeing he was in a state of inebriety, refrained from saying anything. Monday, January 8th. Last night there was a great fandango, or dance among the Spaniards. They kept it up till nearly daylight. Wednesday, January 10th. About noon, Mr. Smith, Captain Cunningham, Mr. Shaw, and Thomas Dodge came to the mission from their ship Courier, and I was much rejoiced to see them, as I have been waiting with anxiety to see him. So runs a portion of the diary of Harrison G. Rogers, a Western Pepys. After weeks of trying negotiations with the suspicious and procrastinating authorities, Smith, with the aid of Captain Cunningham and several other New England seamen then on the coast, managed to get permission to proceed on his way. From San Diego, he sailed to the port of San Pedro on board the Courier with Captain Cunningham, and by the middle of January, 1827, we find him at the Pueblo de Los Angeles, engaged in buying horses for his journey. On the 16th of January, Smith returned to the mission from the Pueblo with the horses he had purchased there. During the following day, preparations were made for resuming the journey, and old Father Sanchez, who had already given much to the visitors, outdid himself in generosity. When the band was ready to start, Daniel Ferguson, who was evidently well pleased with Southern California and had no desire to experience any further hardships in the wilderness, could not be found. John Wilson also remained at San Gabriel, probably by arrangement with Smith. On the 18th of January, 1827, the party, now consisting of 14 men, including Smith, set out northwestward with 68 horses, which, being for the most part unbroken, soon became unmanageable and ran 8 or 10 miles with the packs before they could be stopped. Camp was made that night at the Indian farmhouse where the party had passed the night of November 27, 1826, and Smith and Rogers returned to the mission for a farewell supper with the friendly padres. Traveling in a northeasterly direction for the next 2 days, they made camp within 4 miles of San Bernardino, where, says Rogers, we have an order from the governor and our old Father Joseph Sanchez for all the supplies we stand in need of. Here some days were spent in purchasing provisions, drying meat, making pack saddles, breaking horses, and in rounding up the troublesome herd, which broke away several times. Thence pushing on in a northwesterly direction up the Great Central Valley for a distance of about 300 miles, in early spring the party reached a river which Smith called the Wimolchi, after a tribe of Indians found there. Authorities differ as to the identity of this stream. Chittenden believed it to be the Merced, and Richmond the Moquelumne, but Dale gives us what seems to be conclusive arguments in favor of the Stanislaus. Smith, eager to reach the place of rendezvous agreed upon with Jackson and Sublette, now undertook to cross the Sierras. His chosen route, which is not definitely known, probably ran 25 or 30 miles north of the Yosemite Valley. "I found the snow so deep on Mount Joseph," he wrote to General Clark, "that I could not cross my horses, five of which starved to death. I was compelled, therefore, to return to the valley which I had left, and there, leaving my party, I started with 2 men, 7 horses, and 2 mules, and provisions for ourselves, and started on the 20th of May, and succeeded in crossing it in 8 days, having lost only 2 horses and 1 mule. I found the snow on the top of this mountain from 4 to 8 feet deep, but it was so consolidated by the heat of the sun that my horses only sunk from 0.5 foot to 1 foot deep. One of the men who accompanied Smith is known to have been the blacksmith, Silas Goble. His other companion is nowhere named as such. However, by collating the lists of those who are known to have been, or must have been, in the parties of 1826, 1827, and 1828, it appears that Smith's other companion could have been no other than Robesault. After traveling 20 days from the east side of Mount Joseph, continues Smith's letter, I struck the southwest corner of Great Salt Lake, traveling over a country completely barren and destitute of game. We frequently traveled without water, sometimes for 2 days over sandy deserts, where there was no sign of vegetation, and when we found water in some of the rocky hills, we most generally found some Indians, who appeared the most miserable of the human race, having nothing to subsist on, nor any clothing, except grass seed, grasshoppers, etc. When we arrived at the Salt Lake, we had but 1 horse and 1 mule remaining, which were so feeble and poor that they could scarce carry the little camp equipage which I had along. The balance of my horses I was compelled to eat as they gave out. Thus, characteristically, with few words, Smith describes what was unquestionably a great feat, and what must have been a terrible experience. 20 days of toil and suffering in an unknown desert, and all summed up in 150 words. Most men would require more space for the discussion of an aching tooth. With 2 companions, Smith had at last penetrated the great triangular white space of his dream. He had found no pleasant valleys rich in beaver, but he had been the first to travel the central route between Great Salt Lake and the Pacific Ocean. The road from the Missouri River to San Francisco Bay was now open, awaiting the wagons of the settlers and the official explorers. End of chapter 19. Chapter 20 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schampf. Smith's Second Journey. On about the 17th of June, 1827, Jedediah Smith and his 2 companions, having crossed the Nevada deserts, reached the southern end of Salt Lake, from whence they hastened on to the southern end of Bear Lake, the place chosen by the 3 partners for the summer rendezvous. On July 17th, we find Smith still at the Bear Lake rendezvous, writing a brief account of his recent journey to the Superintendent of Indian Affairs, General William Clark. Shortly thereafter, his second journey to California began. His party consisted of 19 men and 2 Indian women. The names of the men are as follows: Thomas Virgin, for whom the Virgin River was named; Charles Swift; Toussaint Marechal; John Turner; Joseph Palmer; Joseph Lapointe; Thomas Dawes; Richard Taylor; Silas Goble; David Cunningham; Francis Deramay; William Campbell; Bosun Brown; Gregory Ortaga; John B. Rattel; Pale; Polite; Robesault; Isaac Galbraith. Following the same route that he had taken the year before, in late August, Smith reached the country of the Mojave Indians, near the point where the 35th parallel crosses the Colorado River. It will be remembered that Smith spent 15 days with the Mojaves on his way to California the year before. Having good reason to regard them as friendly, he decided to spend a few days among them now, resting his men and horses and purchasing supplies before beginning the difficult westward journey across the desert. He could not know that, during the past year, these Indians had been ordered by Governor Echeandia to stop any Americans who might attempt to pass that way. After spending 3 days in peaceful trade with the Mojaves, Smith prepared to resume his journey. As on his previous trip, he had crossed the Colorado some distance above and was now on the east side of the river. Unconscious of treacherous intent on the part of his hosts, he went about the task of transporting his party to the west bank by means of rafts made of bundles of reeds, the Indians very obligingly lending a hand. Smith and 9 of his men had already crossed. Some of the party was still on the east shore, and the remainder on the raft in midstream, when, at a signal, the Mojaves fell upon their departing guests. The 2 Indian women were taken captive. Thomas Virgin was seriously wounded, and the following 10, who had not yet reached the west bank, were massacred: Goble, Cunningham, Derame, Campbell, Brown, Ortaga, Ratel, Pale, Polite, and Robiseau. All of Smith's property and papers were lost. There was nothing for the survivors to do but to flee into the desert to the west. Traveling both by night and by day, they reached the Spanish settlements near San Gabriel Mission in 9.5 days. Considering the fact that Smith had spent 15 days in covering the same ground on his former trip, one can imagine the mood of desperation that drove him now. Immediately upon arriving at the settlements, Smith reported by letter to the proper authorities, and having purchased some supplies, for the party was destitute, he pushed on northwestwardly up the Central Valley to join the band of 11 men that he had left in the region of the Stanislaus River on its departure for Salt Lake in May of that year. During the absence of their leader, the little band had fared badly, and Smith found them half-starved. He and his companions were no better off, and there was nothing to do but to place himself once more at the doubtful mercy of the Spaniards. So, with 2 Indian guides, Smith went to the mission of San Jose, a 3 days' journey. There he made his wants known, and asked permission to go on to Monterey, where Governor Echeandia was then residing. He was arrested and thrown into a guardhouse, from which, however, he was allowed to write to the captain of the upper province. About 2 weeks passed before he received a letter from the governor, inviting him to call. Then, disarmed and guarded by 4 soldiers, he set out for Monterey, where he arrived at midnight after a journey of 3 days. Again he was thrown into prison, remaining there without food or water until the following noon, when the governor sent for him. As a result of the first interview, Smith obtained liberty of the limits of the town and harbor, and of boarding with an American gentleman, Captain Cooper, of Boston. Day after day passed by, and still Echeandia could not make up his mind as to what should be done with this American trapper, who had actually committed the crime of entering Mexican territory. At times it seemed that the intruder would be sent to Mexico. Again, he must leave the country by ship. At other times, the whole party yonder in the region of the Stanislaus was to be summoned to Monterey. Finally, when it became apparent that the governor was quite incapable of a decision, 4 American sea captains, whose vessels were lying in the harbor, took the matter into their own hands and appointed Captain Cooper agent for the United States. Cooper soon settled the matter, and on November 15, 1827, Smith gave bond in the sum of $30,000, promising to leave the country within 2 months. Smith had left 19 men encamped in the region of the Stanislaus when he went to Monterey, and during his tedious negotiations with the governor, these had been brought into San Francisco, where Smith now joined them after purchasing some horses, guns, ammunition, and other necessities. Thomas Virgin, who had been left in the South because of his wounds, was sent for. At about this time, 2 of the men, who seemed to have been Isaac Galbraith and the quarrelsome blacksmith James Reed, deserted, leaving the following 19 in the band that began the return journey early in December: Smith, Rogers, Virgin, Black, Lapointe, Dawes, Laplante, Swift, Turner, Gator, Hanna, Lazarus, Palmer, Rene the Negro, Taylor, McCoy, Rubasco, Marischal, and Evans. Trapping as they went, these moved slowly up the Sacramento River, spending considerable time on the largest tributary of that stream, which for that reason has since been called American Fork. it seems to have been Smith's intention to cross the Sierras as early in the spring as possible and return to Salt Lake through the unknown country lying north of his route of 1827. But in April 1828, after several unsuccessful attempts to find a practicable pass to the eastward, he was forced to change his plan and make for the Columbia. He now left the Sacramento Valley, striking out through the mountainous country in the direction of the coast. By the 13th of May, 1828, he had crossed the Trinity River near latitude 40 degrees 30 minutes and reached the base of Hoopa Mountain. The following extracts from the journal kept by Rogers during this time will give some idea of the difficulties encountered by the party. Wednesday, May 14th. We made an early start, directing our course northwest, and traveled 4 miles and encamped on the top of a high mountain, where there was but indifferent grass for the horses. The traveling amazingly bad. We descended one point of brushy and rocky mountain, where it took us about 6 hours to get the horses down, some of them falling about 50 feet perpendicular down a steep place into a creek. One broke his neck. A number of packs left along the trail as night was fast approaching, and we were obliged to leave them and get what horses we could collected at camp. A number more got badly hurt by the falls, but none killed but this one that broke his neck. Saw some Indians, Hoopas, that crossed the river in a canoe and came to see us. They appear afraid of horses. They are very light-colored Indians, quite small and talkative. Thursday, 15th May, 1828. The men were divided into parties this morning. Some sent hunting, as we have no meat in camp. Others sent back for the horses. Friday, May 16th, 1828. We concluded that it was best to lie by today and send 2 men to look out a pass to travel, as the country looks awful ahead, and let our horses rest, as there is plenty good grass about 1 mile off for them to feed on. Saturday, May 17th. The 2 men that were sent on discovery yesterday return this morning and say that we are 15 or 20 miles from the North Pacific Ocean. They report game plenty, such as elk and deer. They report the traveling favorable to what it has been for 30 or 40 miles back. The 2 men, Marischal and Turner, that were sent off yesterday killed 3 deer, and Captain Smith has dispatched 2 men after the meet, as the camp is almost destitute. Monday, May 19th. We made an early start this morning, steering our course as yesterday, 6 miles west, and encamped on the side of the mountain. The traveling some better than it was back, although we have hills and brush to encounter yet. We encamped about 6 miles from the ocean, where we have a fair view of it. Tuesday, May 20th. As our horses were lame and tired, we concluded to remain here and let them rest and kill and dry meat, as elk appeared to be plenty from the sign. After breakfast, myself and Mr. Virgin started on horseback for the seashore, following an Indian trail that led immediately there. After proceeding about 5 miles west, we found we could not get any further on horseback along the Indian trail, so we struck out from the creek that we had followed down, and about 3 miles from where we had first struck it. After leaving the creek with some considerable difficulty, we ascended a point of steep and brushy mountain that runs along parallel to the seashore, and followed that until we could get no further for rocks and brush. We got within 80 or 100 yards of the beach, but being pretty much fatigued and not able to ride down on account of rocks and brush, we did not proceed any further in that direction. On our return, we saw some elk. I went after them, and Mr. Virgin stayed with the horses. I did not get to fire on them, and saw a black bear, and made after him, and shot and wounded him very badly, and heard Mr. Virgin shoot and call me to come to him. I made all the haste I could in climbing the mountain to where Mr. Virgin was. He told me that some Indians had attacked him in my absence, shot a number of arrows at him, and wounded the horses. I rested a few minutes and proceeded on cautiously to the place where he had left the horses and found an Indian lying dead and his dog by him. Mr. Virgin's horse had 2 or 3 arrows in him and he lying down. We got him up and made camp a little before night. Wednesday, May 21st, still at the same camp. The timber in this part of the country is principally hemlock, pine, and white cedar, the cedar trees from 5 to 15 feet in diameter. The underbrush is hazel, oak, briars, currants, gooseberry, and scotch cap bushes, together with alder and sundry other shrubs too tedious to mention. The soil of the country is very rich and black, but very mountainous, which renders the traveling almost impossible with so many horses as we have. Thursday, May 22nd. All hands up early and preparing for a move. Had the horses driven to camp and caught ready for packing up, and it commenced raining so fast that we concluded to remain here today, as we could not see to direct our course for fog along the mountains. We have not seen or heard any Indians since the 20th, when Mr. Virgin killed the one that shot at his horse. Oh, God, may it please thee in thy divine providence to still guide and protect us through this wilderness of doubt and fear, as thou hast done heretofore, and be with us in the hour of danger and difficulty, as all praise is due to thee and not to man. Oh, do not forsake us, Lord, but be with us and direct us through. For nearly 2 weeks thereafter, the party wandered about the rugged country, seeking a way down to the coast, and more than once they found it necessary to turn back over hard-won miles because of some impassable barrier. During this time, they were forced to kill their last dog for food, as they were entirely out of provisions, with the exception of a few pounds of flour and rice. Finally, on June 8th, they managed to reach the ocean near the mouth of the Klamath River and camped on the beach. Henceforth, they kept to the coast, sometimes riding at the very lip of the surf, sometimes swinging a mile or so inland. Now and then, the deep and yawning mouth of a stream made it necessary to build rafts. Game was somewhat more plentiful now, and various articles of food, such as camas root, clams, dried fish and berries, were bought with beads from the Indians, who generally displayed rather more fear than friendliness, and sometimes risked a sneaking hostility. On the 23rd of June, the party crossed the 42nd parallel, the northern boundary of the Mexican country. Under date of July 2nd, Rogers tells us that, as the most of the men's times expired this evening, Captain Smith called all hands and gave them up their articles, and engaged the following men to go on with him until he reaches the place of deposit, viz. John Gaitier, Arthur Black, John Hanna, Emmanuel Lazarus, Abraham LaPlante, Charles Swift, Thomas Dawes, Toussaint Marechal. Dawes' time to commence when he gets well enough for duty. Also Peter Rene and Joseph Palmer at the above-named price, $1 per day, and Martin McCoy, $200 from the time he left the Spanish country until he reaches the deposit. On the 4th of July, so Rogers tells us, Marechal caught a boy about 10 years old and brought him to camp. I gave him some beads and dried meat. He appears well satisfied. Still pushing northward along the coast, on July 11th, the party reached the Umpqua River and camped near a village of Umpqua Indians, who seemed altogether friendly. The last two entries made by Rogers in his diary run as follows. Saturday, July 12th. We commenced crossing the river early and had our goods and horses over by 8 o'clock, then packed up and started a northeast course up the river and traveled 3 miles and encamped. Had several Indians along. One of the Indians stole an axe, and we were obliged to seize him for the purpose of tying him before we could scare him to make him give it up. Captain Smith and one of them caught him and put a cord around his neck, and the rest of us stood with our guns ready in case they made any resistance. There were about 50 Indians present, but they did not pretend to resist tying the other. The river at this place is about 300 yards wide and makes a large bay that extends 4 or 5 miles up in the Pine Hills. We traded some land and sea otter and beaver fur in the course of the day. Those Indians bring Pacific raspberries and other berries. Sunday, July 13th, 1828. We made a pretty good start this morning, directing our course along the bay east, and traveled 4 miles and encamped. 50 or 60 Indians in camp again today. We traded 15 or 20 beaver skins from them, some elk meat and tallow, also some lamprey eels. The traveling quite miry in places. We got a number of our pack horses mired and had to bridge several places. A considerable thunder shower this morning, and rain at intervals through the day. Those Indians tell us after we get up the river 15 or 20 miles, we will have good traveling to the Wyhamet or Multnomah, where the Kalapoo Indians live. While writing these words, the last he would ever write, Rogers must have felt that his earnest prayers had been answered. The Wyhamet or Multnomah was the Willamette River. A day or two of easy travel, and they would be in the valley of that stream, with a good trail leading northward down to the Columbia, and the great post of the Hudson Bay Company, Fort Vancouver. Both by trapping and through trade with the natives, they had, in spite of their hardships, accumulated a large amount of beaver fur during their long northward journey through a virgin wilderness. And though they were still far from their comrades under Sublette and Jackson, the unknown country had been passed, and henceforth they would travel by river valleys all the way to the headwaters of the Snake, where the main body would be waiting. Doubtless it was a merry company that camped on the north bank of the Umpqua that night of July 13, 1828. Early the next morning, Smith, as had been his habit, started afoot up the river to find a good trail for his party, the country being very swampy in the lowlands and woody in the mountains. One account states that he went alone, another that he went with a little Englishman and an Indian, a third that he was accompanied by two of his party and one Umpqua. Strict orders were given that no Indians should be admitted to the camp during his absence, but scarcely had he disappeared upriver when the order was disobeyed. The penalty for disobedience was swift and terrible. On July 12th, it will be remembered, Smith had dealt rather roughly with the Indian who had stolen an axe. This man, who happened to be a chief, now seized the opportunity to avenge his wounded dignity. At a signal from him, the Indians, outnumbering the little band 3-1, attacked the unsuspecting trappers. Effective resistance was out of the question. 15 of the white men went down at once under the knives of the Indians. Only 2 of those in camp escaped, Black and Turner. At the moment when the signal for the attack was given, Black, who seems to have been out of the crowd, had just cleaned and loaded his gun. 3 Indians leaped upon him, but he succeeded in shaking them off, and seeing his comrades down and fighting hopelessly, he fired into the mass of Indians and fled into the heavily wood country to the north. Turner, a very large and powerful man, was serving as cook that day. Having no weapon within reach when the savages fell upon him, he snatched a burning stick from the fire, knocked down 4 of his assailants, and ran upstream in the direction taken by Smith, whom he met returning at some distance from the camp. Turner was under the impression that he was the sole survivor of the camp, and realizing the impossibility of coping with their numerous enemies, these fled together up the Umpqua and across the divide to the Willamette. Black, in the meantime, was following the coast northward, convinced that he alone had escaped. In his autobiography, Dr. McLaughlin, factor of Fort Vancouver on the Columbia, gives the following account of the affair. One night in August 1828, I was surprised by the Indians making a great noise at the gate of the fort, saying that they had brought an American. The gate was opened. The man, Black, came in, but was so affected he could not speak. After sitting down some minutes to recover himself, he told us he was, he thought, the only survivor of 18 men conducted by Jedediah Smith. All the rest, he thought, were murdered. Broken down by hunger and misery, as he had no food but a few wild berries which he found on the beach, he determined to give himself up to the Killamore, a tribe on the coast of Cape Lookout, who treated him with great humanity, relieved his wants, and brought him to the fort, for which, in case whites might again fall in their power, and to induce them to act kindly to them, I rewarded them most liberally. But as Smith and his 2 men might have escaped, and, if we made no search for them, die at daybreak the next morning, I sent Indian runners with tobacco to the Willamette chiefs to tell them to send their people in search of Smith and his 2 men, and if they found them, to bring them to the fort, and I would pay them. and telling them if any Indians hurt these men, we would punish them, and immediately equipped a strong party of 40 well-armed men. But as the men were embarking, to our great joy, Smith and his two men arrived. I then arranged as strong a party as I could make to recover all we could of Smith's property. I divulged my plan to none, but gave written instructions to the officer to be opened early when he got to the Umpqua, because if known before they got there, the officers would talk of it among themselves, the men would hear it, and from them it would go to their Indian wives, who were spies on us, and my plan would be defeated. The plan was that the officer was, as usual, to invite the Indians to bring their furs to trade, just as if nothing had happened. Count the furs, but as the American trappers mark all their skins, keep these all separate, give them to Smith, and not pay the Indians for them, telling them that they belong to him, that they got them by murdering Smith's people. As a result of this expedition sent out, from a principle of Christian duty by Dr. McLaughlin, Smith recovered most of his peltry, which he sold to the Hudson Bay Company, receiving, therefore, a draft on London for $20,000. Some of the horses of the ill-fated party were also returned, together with a few articles of personal property, among which was the diary of Harrison G. Rogers, which we have been quoting. In order to appreciate the magnanimity of Dr. McLaughlin, it must be remembered that the firm of Smith, Jackson, and Sublette was then coming to be regarded as a somewhat dangerous competitor, and considering the manner in which the Americans had relieved Ogden of a fortune in furs during the spring of 1825, a lesser man than McLaughlin might have seized this opportunity to enjoy the discomfiture of his rivals. In his Pioneer Days of Oregon History, S.A. Clark, who knew McLaughlin, has left us the following tribute to this fine old gentleman. Over 6 feet in height, powerfully made, with a grand head on massive shoulders and long snow-white locks covering them, he was a splendid picture of a man. The Indians knew him as the White Eagle, and they respected him as they never did anyone else. He was a convert to Catholicism, and in no sense was he a bigot or lacking in the Christian charity that recognizes true effort with goodwill whenever it is met. His policy to effect peace with the Indians was potent for good. With his grand manner and majestic port, heightened by white waving hair, he was the embodiment of power and justice. He was indeed, as he was styled, the Tsar of the West. His rule was imperial for 1,000 miles, and his mere word was law. Yet there was a genuine beneficence in his nature that overcame the pride of life and the lust of the flesh, and made him the special providence to open the Canaan of the Occident to the civilization of the East. End of chapter 20. Chapter 21 of The Splendid Wayfaring by John G. Neihardt. This Librivox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Phil Schempf. The End of the Trail. During the absence of Jedediah Smith, the main body of trappers under Sublette and Jackson had been working in the upper Snake River country, and in the fall of 1828 they returned to Great Salt Lake for the winter. Shortly afterward, Sublette started for St. Louis with the furs, traveling by way of South Pass and the Platte. He reached his destination about the middle of December, 1828, and in March, 1829, began the return journey to the mountains with 60 men and a train of supplies. He ascended the North Platte to the Sweetwater, thence heading for the Popoagi, a southern tributary of the Wind River, where the summer rendezvous was to be held. Reaching the appointed place about July 1st, he found there a greater portion of the band that had wintered at Salt Lake. Jackson had remained with a small party west of the Great Divide. According to Joseph Meek, who made his first trip to the mountains that year, the rendezvous lasted until about the 1st of August. In this period, says Meek, the men, Indian allies, and other Indian parties who usually visited the camp at this time were all supplied with goods. The remaining merchandise was adjusted for the convenience of the different traders, who should be sent out through all the country traversed by the company. Sublette then decided upon their routes, dividing up his forces into camps, which took each its appointed course, detaching as it went small parties of trappers to all the hunting grounds in the neighborhood. Sublette himself now set forth to find Smith, who had agreed to meet him on the upper waters of the Snake River. He pushed up the Wind River, crossed the mountains, and entered the valley, now called Jackson's Hole, after the partner whom he found encamped there. For some time Sublette and Jackson waited at this point for Jedediah Smith. Finally, growing uneasy, Sublette sent small parties out in various directions to search for the missing partner. One of these bands wandered into Pierre's Hole, an emerald cup set in its rim of amethystine mountains, and there, with but four men, one of whom was Arthur Black, Smith was found trapping along the streams of the beautiful valley. He had spent the winter of 1828-29 at Fort Vancouver as the guest of the venerable Dr. McLaughlin, and in March he had resumed his journey toward the place of rendezvous, ascending the Columbia to a point near the Big Bend, thence striking out north and east to Flathead House, from whence, turning southward along the route he had followed with Ogden in the winter of 1824-25, he had reached Pierre's Hole. We are told that there was great rejoicing over the finding of Smith, and well might this be, though it is doubtful if the importance of what this man had accomplished was thoroughly understood by his comrades. His had been the first overland party of Americans to reach California. He had been the first white man to travel the central route from Salt Lake to the Pacific, and the first to traverse the full length of California and Oregon by land. Of the 32 men who had shared in his adventures, 25 had been slain by the Mojaves and the Umpquas. During 3 years of wandering west of the Rockies, he had covered 14 degrees of latitude and 11 degrees of longitude. It was one of the greatest western explorers that Sublette's men found trapping in Pierre's Hole that summer of 1829, and he was then but 31 years old. During his sojourn with Dr. McLaughlin at Fort Vancouver, Smith, by way of showing gratitude for the generosity of his host, had agreed that the firm of which he was a member should henceforth confine its operations to the country east of the Great Divide. Accordingly, after spending the balance of the summer in Pierre's Hole, the three partners crossed over to the headwaters of the Madison Fork of the Missouri. During the fall and early winter of 1829, the various parties of the firm worked the country lying between the sources of the Missouri and Yellowstone, finally going into winter quarters on the Wind River. While the camp was celebrating Christmas, William L. Sublette and Black Harris, with a few dogs to carry their blankets and supplies, started on snowshoes for St. Louis. Sublette took with him a letter from Jed Smith to his brother Ralph of Ashtabula, Ohio, urging the latter to come west. Shortly after the departure of Sublette and Harris, the party on the Wind River, finding the pasturage there insufficient for the horses, moved to the Powder River. After much wandering and many stirring adventures during the spring and early summer of 1830, the party moved back to the valley of the Wind River, where the rendezvous of that year was to be held. On the 10th of July, Sublette arrived with 81 men mounted on mules, 10 loaded wagons drawn by 5 mule teams, 2 Dearborn buggies, a milk cow, and 12 head of steers, the latter having been driven along as an insurance against famine until the buffalo country should be reached. The wagons and buggies brought out by Sublette that year were the first to trundle up the great natural road soon to be known as the Oregon and California Trail. The Wind River rendezvous of 1830 was the last ever held by the firm of Smith, Jackson, and Sublette, for in the first week of August the business was sold to a new firm called the Rocky Mountain Fur Company, and composed of Thomas Fitzpatrick, Milton G. Sublette, a brother of William L., Henry Frabe, Jean-Baptiste Gervais, and James Bridger. Immediately after the sale, Smith, Jackson, and Sublette began the journey to St. Louis, with 190 packs of beaver, worth about $80,000. Reaching the city in October 1830, Jed found his two brothers, Austin and Peter, awaiting his arrival, Ralph having been unable to leave home. At that time, the golden era of the Rocky Mountain fur trade was nearing its end, and more the adventurous spirits of the frontier were becoming interested in the overland traffic with Taos and Santa Fe, New Mexico. Until the beginning of the 19th century, New Mexico had received all its imported goods from Veracruz over a long and difficult trail. But early in the century, American merchants had begun to realize the fact that goods could be transported more cheaply to New Mexico by way of the Missouri River and the Great Plains than from any Mexican port. In 1804, one Morrison, a merchant of the old French town of Kaskaskia, succeeded in sending a pack train of merchandise to Santa Fe, but lost the profits of his venture through the dishonesty of his agent. Other merchants followed the example of Morrison, but none attained any conspicuous success during the next 17 years. Josiah Gregg, the principal authority on this unique phase of westward expansion, tells us that the Santa Fe trade may be dated from the year 1821, when Captain William Becknell of Missouri, with four trusty companions, went out to Santa Fe by the far western prairie route. This band started from Franklin, a town on the Missouri River, 200 miles above its mouth. Notwithstanding the trifling amount of merchandise they were possessed of, says Gregg, they realized a handsome profit, and thereafter the trade with Santa Fe increased rapidly. In 1822, the value of merchandise transported westward across the prairies and the deserts was $15,000. In 1824, $35,000. In 1825, $65,000. In 1827, $90,000. In 1828, $150,000. In 1831, $250,000. Up to the year 1823, pack animals alone were used. In 1824, wagons were employed for the first time, and after 1826, all traffic was by wagon. It will be remembered that when Jedediah Smith first landed in St. Louis, the great period of the fur trade was just beginning, and men talked of little else than the fortunes that could be realized in that romantic industry. 8 years had passed since that time, and now the Santa Fe trade was the talk of the town. Smith, in company with his brothers, Peter and Austin, and his partners, Sublette and Jackson, decided to engage in this new business. On April 10, 1831, the Smith Party, consisting of 85 men, started from St. Louis with 22 loaded wagons and a 6-pound cannon. Traveling up the valley of the Missouri River, they met Thomas Fitzpatrick near Lexington. He was returning to St. Louis from the Yellowstone country, but was easily persuaded to accompany his old comrades to Santa Fe. Near the last of April, the party reached the town of Independence, which, though but 4 years old, had already come to be the point of rendezvous for the Santa Fe traders, as well as for the Rocky Mountain trappers. Formerly, the town of Franklin, 187 miles downstream, had been the point of departure, but with the founding of Independence in 1827, the latter place was found to be more convenient, being the westernmost settlement on the Missouri, a stream that was navigable for at least 8 months during the year, and offered a cheap and easy means of transportation from St. Louis. On the 4th of May, 1831, the wagon train of Smith, Jackson, and Sublette moved out from Independence on the road to Santa Fe, with 775 miles of prairie wilderness ahead. The first point of importance reached after leaving the border was Council Grove, 150 miles out, a wooded valley lying along a branch of the Neosho River. Here it was customary for the westbound parties to halt for the purpose of electing officers, deciding upon the order of march, agreeing to the rules that should be obeyed, and defining the duties that should be performed by each member. Josiah Gregg, who started with a caravan for Santa Fe just 11 days after the departure of Smith's party, has left us a vivid account of the organization and personnel of these parties. "One would have supposed," he writes, "that electioneering and party spirit would hardly have penetrated so far into the wilderness, but so it was. Even in our little community, we had our office seekers and their political adherents, as earnest and devoted as any of the modern school of politicians in the midst of civilization. When a captain of the caravan had been elected, the business of organization began. The proprietors were notified by proclamation to furnish a list of their men and wagons. The latter were generally apportioned into four divisions. To each of these divisions a lieutenant was appointed, whose duty it was to inspect every ravine and creek on the route, select the best crossings, and superintend what is called in prairie parlance the forming of the caravan. "The wild and motley character of the caravan," continues Grigg, "can be but imperfectly conceived without an idea of the costumes of the various members. The most fashionable prairie dress is the fustian frock of the city-bred merchant, furnished with a multitude of pockets capable of accommodating a variety of extra tackling. Then there is the backwoodsman with his linsey or leather hunting shirt, the farmer with the blue jean coat, the wagoner with his flannel sleeve vest, besides an assortment of other costumes which go to fill up the picture. In the article of firearms there is also an equally interesting medley. The frontier hunter sticks to his rifle, as nothing could induce him to carry what he terms in derision the scatter gun. The sportsman from the interior flourishes his double-barrel fowling piece with equal confidence in its superiority. The latter is certainly the most convenient description of a gun that can be carried on the journey, as a charge of buckshot in night attacks, which are the most common, will of course be more likely to do execution than a single rifle ball fired at random. A great many were furnished besides with a bountiful supply of pistols and knives of every description." At the Council Grove, the laborers were employed in procuring timber for axle trees and other wagon repairs, of which a supply is always laid in before leaving this region of substantial growths, for henceforward there is no wood on the route fit for these purposes. Not even in the mountains of Santa Fe do we meet with any serviceable timber. The supply procured here is generally lashed under the wagons, in which way a log is not infrequently carried to Santa Fe, and even sometimes back again. Final preparations having been made at Council Grove, the caravan began the journey in earnest. Grigg tells us that when the nature of the country would permit, it was customary to march in four columns, and he remarks that a caravan proceeding in this manner presented a very fine and imposing spectacle. In making camp for the night, or in case of attack by Indians during the day, the wagons were thus easily placed in the most advantageous position for defense, the exterior columns swinging outward and then meeting, the two interior columns falling back and wheeling outward to form a quadrangle with the first two columns. Into the corral thus formed, the animals were driven, thus rendering a stampede impossible. While protected by the hollow square of heavily loaded wagons, the men were enabled to render a very good account of themselves in case of a scrimmage. The caravan of Smith, Jackson, and Sublette pushed forward rapidly, reaching the ford of the Arkansas River, 392 miles west of Independence, in about 3 weeks. Thus far, no considerable difficulties had been encountered, and though they had lost one man who had strayed away from the main body and been killed by Pawnees, they had every reason to be in the best of spirits, for they had now covered slightly more than half the distance to Santa Fe. However, they were now about to enter upon the most difficult stage of the whole journey. After crossing the Arkansas, the route led for a distance of over 60 miles across a region of utter desolation to the forks of the Cimarron River. This tract of country, says Grigg, may truly be styled the Grand Prairie Ocean, for not a single landmark is to be seen for more than 40 miles, scarcely a visible eminence by which to direct one's course. All is as level as the sea, and the compass was our surest as well as our principal guide. Before entering this desert, it was customary to lay in a good supply of water. Smith and his comrades seem to have neglected this precaution, hoping doubtless to find occasional water holes, but the summer of 1831 was unusually dry, and no water holes were found. Within 2 days after striking out from the Arkansas, the party began to experience the tortures of thirst, and the famished animals began to die. Confused by a maze of buffalo trails that led nowhere, taunted and misled by lying mirages, Smith and his comrades struggled onward. We will let Josiah Grigg tell the rest of the melancholy story. He had it from a Mexican buffalo hunter, who in turn had been told by the Comanche Indians, themselves protagonists in the final act of the tragedy. In this perilous situation, Captain Smith resolved at last to pursue one of the seductive buffalo paths, in hopes it might lead to the margin of some stream or pond. He set out alone, for besides the temerity which desperation always inspires, he had ever been a stranger to fear. Indeed, he was one of the most undaunted spirits that had ever traversed the Rocky Mountains. But alas, for unfortunate Captain Smith, after having so often dodged the arrow and eluded the snare of the wily mountain Indian, little could he have thought, while jogging along under a scorching sun, that his bones were destined to bleach upon those arid sands. He had already wandered many miles away from his comrades, when on turning over an eminence, his eyes were joyfully greeted with the appearance of a small stream meandering through the valley that spread before him. It was the Cimarron. He hurried forward to slake the fire of his parched lips. But imagine his disappointment at finding in the channel only a bed of dry sand. With his hands, however, he soon scratched out a basin a foot or two deep, into which the water slowly oozed from the saturated sand, while with his head bent down in the effort to quench his burning thirst, he was pierced by arrows of a gang of Comanches, who were lying in wait for him. Yet he struggled bravely to the last, and as the Indians themselves have since related, killed two or three of their party before he was overpowered. Thus, on the 27th of May, 1831, died Jedediah Strong Smith at the age of 33. No monument marks the spot where this great Western explorer met his end. His bones were picked by the wolves and crows and left to bleach in the arid bed of the Cimarron until the next freshet should bury them in the sands. At winter quarters on the Wind River, in December 1829, Smith had written as follows to his brother Ralph, and no man who knew him ever questioned his sincerity. "It is that I may be able to help those who stand in need that I face every danger. It is for this that I pass over the sandy plains, in heat of summer, thirsting for water where I may cool my overheated body. It is for this that I go for days without eating, and am pretty well satisfied if I can gather a few roots, a few snails, or better satisfied if we can afford ourselves a piece of horseflesh or a fine roasted dog. And most of all, it is for this that I deprive myself of the privilege of society and the satisfaction of the converse of my friends." Let his own words be his epitaph. End of chapter 21. End of The Splendid Wayfaring, the story of the exploits and adventures of Jedediah Smith and his comrades, the Ashley Henry men, discoverers and explorers of the great central route from the Missouri River to the Pacific Ocean, 1822 to 1831, by John G. Neihardt.